special TGIF today. Of course, they're all special, but especially special today because not only do we have our distinguished CEO Eric dressed in a suit with a tie and everything. But we also have Tom Friedman dressed in a tie and a suit and the whole kit and caboodle. I assume Tom needs no introduction and having been here a number of times before, but we are very delighted to have him here again now with his new book out. And I'm very anxious to hear what he has to say. And Eric, take it away.
So it is a huge pleasure to welcome you back to Google. The title of your book is The World is Flat. And that view kind of went out of style maybe 500 years ago. But I want to make sure first, I want to give credit to John Doerr and our friends at Kleiner Perkins for including you, you know, as part of this. You're on the book tour, and in addition to having this very curious title, in 1 week, you're the number one highest rated book in the New York Times book magazine, right to the top of the bestseller list. So, I, of course, read your column today. And, you know, using the old technology. And the important thing here about The World is Flat is you figured it out. And when you came to Google last time, you were doing research for this book. So tell us, what were the things that caused you to do this analysis? You said there were 10 things that came together to prove something which has been false for 500 years.
Well, it's a great way to frame the question, Eric. And first of all, thank you for having me here again. Eric and Sergey, thank you for the introduction. And John Doerr, thank you for making it possible in this crazy day to get me back and forth. It's really a treat to be here. I am at the end of a 6-week book tour, and this is one of my very last stops. And I've been really looking forward to this. I was trying to think back, Eric, to our last conversation. And I believe I was here almost a year ago. So it was in June. It was really before I went on sabbatical. And let me just sort of recap one thing and then try to tell you what kind of came together after I was here in terms of my own thinking. This book was spawned, as I think I talked a little bit last time, quite by accident. I've been doing documentaries for the Discovery Channel for the last few years. And back in January of 2004, we were trying to figure out what to do our next documentary on. We had done one on the wall in Israel, in the West Bank. We'd done one on the roots of 9/11. And at that time, the issue of why the world hates America was sort of this big, hot issue. And I had this idea that we should go to call centers all over the world and interview young people who spend their days imitating Americans on what they thought of America. And I thought it would be a very interesting kind of double image, you know. And literally, we were costing that trip out when John Kerry came out with his blast against Benedict Arnold executives who outsource. And suddenly, outsourcing became this super hot issue. And I decided with Discovery that maybe we should just go to Bangalore and do a documentary called The Other Side of Outsourcing and look at this from the ground up. And we did about 60 hours of interviews in the course of 10, 11 days there. And throughout those interviews, I really got progressively sicker and sicker. And it wasn't the food. It was somewhere between the Indian entrepreneur who wanted to do my taxes from Bangalore, and the one who wanted to write my new software from Bangalore, and the one who wanted to read my x-rays from Bangalore, and the one who wanted to trace my lost luggage on Delta Airlines from Bangalore. I began to realize that while I had been sleeping, while I'd been off covering the 9/11 war, something really big had happened in this globalization story, and I had missed it. And the last interview we did was with Nandan Nilekani, who's the head of Infosys. And actually, before the interview started, we were sitting on the couch outside his office, and Nandan really just mentioned in passing, not so much in passing, in talking about what he was going to talk about, he said, "Tom, the global economic playing field is being leveled, and you Americans are not ready." Oh, I wrote that down in my little notebook. You know, the global economic playing field is being leveled. And the book really emerged because on the bus ride back from the hotel, from emphasis to the hotel, I just kept rolling that over in my head. The playing field is being leveled. What Nandan is telling me, I finally realized was that the playing field was being flattened. And then really the brainstorm that produced the book happened on some pothole, you know, on the road to my hotel. I suddenly realized what he was telling me was that the world was flat. And he was actually citing this as a great achievement in human development, that we'd made the world flat. So I went back to the hotel, I called my wife, I said, honey, I'm gonna write a book called The World is Flat. She thought I was stark raving mad. But I came home and told the publisher of the New York Times and my editor, Gail Collins, the editor of the editorial page, I basically told them, I've gotta go on leave immediately. Because my software, the analytical framework through which I'm looking at the world and trying to understand foreign affairs, is out of date. And I need to update it. And if I don't update it immediately, I'm gonna write something really stupid in the New York Times. It's a great way to get a leave, I gotta say. Okay. All right, it's just, can't beat it. I mean, it's hard to say no, right? You know, so that's really what I've been doing, and that's what really brought me to Google last June and whatnot. And you recall when I was here last time, Eric, I talked to you and to Larry and Sergey about, you know, this idea of kind of the thing that really struck me when I was in Bangalore, and because I had been off covering the 9/11 wars all that time, in fact, one time came here and talked about it, that when I would sit across the table from someone like Jerry Rao, the head of NASSCOM, the Indian High Tech Association, and I would sort of end every interview after the cameras went off by saying, Jerry, what did I miss? Something's happened. What did I miss? And it was really in a quest to answer that question. Because people were offering to do things. They were telling me they were doing things that I really couldn't explain, you know. And so the second chapter of the book really is called The 10 Days That Flattened the World, and it's about the 10 forces and events that came together. And I talked about that last time, the different forces that I thought created this level playing field. But what I did after I left here, Eric, was in working on it more and thinking it through more, I actually tied those 10 flatteners together into what I think was more of a conceptual framework. It wasn't just 10 things. And maybe I'll go through them really quickly and try to explain what I mean.
You don't think it's just broadband and the internet?
It's not just broadband and the internet, no. The 10 flatteners, you know, for me were first 11-9. 11-9 is the day the Berlin Wall came down, 11-9-89. That was hugely important because it allowed us to look at the world as a single flat plane. And the first flattener is called When the Walls Came Down and the Windows Came Up, because the Windows operating system shipped 5 months after the fall of the Berlin Wall. So the two things happened at the same time. We got to see the world as a single flat plane.
One still crashes.
And one still crashes. No, I didn't say that. He said that. Ooh, God.
We use more reliable.
That's very good. That is so good. The second flattener was 8/9/95, and that was the day Netscape went public. And I argued that Netscape went public was helped obviously bring the internet alive, gave us open standards to make sure no company dominated the internet, and thirdly, triggered the dot-com boom, which triggered the dot-com bubble, which triggered the accidental overinvestment in all this fiber optic cable. The third flattener I simply call workflow, and that was all the stuff and standards, all the software that basically connected all that bandwidth with all those PCs. And the idea that over the 1990s, a kind of quiet revolution happened in workflow that allowed everyone's application to connect to everyone else's application. So when I left here, basically, I realized that actually these first three were actually the genesis moment of the flat world. Because once you had an internet that came alive, I would argue, thanks to the browser, suddenly you had people able to connect with people like never before. And more cheaply than ever, thanks to all that fiber optic cable. Once you had applications that were made interoperable with other applications, it meant people could work together on more different stuff than ever before. And when you put the two together, what you really got, I think, was the genesis moment of the flat world. That is, when we could connect with each other and when we could work together, what we created was a global platform for multiple forms of collaboration. Suddenly more people could collaborate on more stuff than ever before. Well, then I thought about my next six flatteners, which when I was here were just sort of six things. And what I realized, what these were the six new forms of collaboration that sprung from this platform. So they are very quickly outsourcing. Well, outsourcing is just a new form of collaboration. The second is offshoring. Outsourcing is I take my finance department and move it to North Palo Alto, North Dakota, or North Bangalore. Off this new platform, either one is equally easy. Offshoring is where I take my whole factory and move it from Canton, Ohio to Canton, China. The third one is open sourcing. I realize open sourcing is just a new form of collaboration now for making everything from free software to Wikipedia. The fourth new form of collaboration I call supply chaining. When I was here, I talked about Walmart. But Walmart's just a metaphor for a new form of collaboration where you take supply chaining down to the last atom of efficiency. So an item is taken off the shelf in a Walmart in San Francisco, and another is immediately made in Shenzhen, China. If Walmart were a country, today it would be China's eighth largest trading partner after India and after Canada and Australia. So, Yossi Sheffi, who does supply chain logistics at MIT, has a nice saying. He says, you know, making stuff, that's easy. Supply chain, that's really hard. And when you think about it, it's kind of interesting. Walmart's the biggest company in America today and doesn't make a thing other than supply chain. So supply chaining, new form of collaboration. The fifth new form of collaboration I call insourcing. That's what UPS does. They come inside your company now and take over your whole internal logistics. As I came to study more about UPS, I came to realize that the people in the funny brown trucks and the funny brown shirts and shorts were not just delivering packages. They're doing internal logistics. And the example I give in the book, of course, is Toshiba laptop. Your Toshiba breaks. You call Toshiba. They say, bring it to the UPS store. Ship it to us. We'll fix it in 72 hours and send it back. Of course, what you don't know is it goes from the UPS store to the UPS hub at Louisville Airport in Kentucky, where in a clean room, in a hangar, airline hangar at Louisville Airport, your Toshiba laptop is repaired by a UPS employee. And it never touches Toshiba's hands. And this is true now for a lot of things, everything from Nike.com to Papa John's pizzas. Their trucks are actually driven by UPS employees. So insourcing, a new form of collaboration. And this is going to be very interesting because this is going to drive a lot of standards. Because as you take this down from big companies to want to do it to little companies, for little companies, you're going to require lots of standards, huge flattener. And the sixth and last form of collaboration was Google. And at the time, I just said it was Google. But I realized that what you do is a form of collaboration I call informing. Because I can now inform myself. I could collaborate with data all by myself. So to me, Google, TiVo are new forms of collaboration. I can inform myself on entertainment. I can inform myself on information. I wrote this book without a research assistant. My researcher was Google. You know, I wrote my first book. I wrote Beirut to Jerusalem. I wrote Beirut to Jerusalem. I had a physical researcher. He sat next to me. He brought me physical paper. I handed him physical money. I wrote this book. I wrote this book entirely with Google as my research assistant. And I found it was not only more efficient, but actually I discovered and stumbled over so many things I never would have found had I not been informing myself. So now we have the first three. They created this platform for collaboration. With the next six, I realized, are the new forms of collaboration that have sprung off this platform and flattened the world even more. Well, that's nine, and I said there were 10 when I was here. So I scratched my head, what is the 10th? And when I was here, I talked about wireless. But I realized the 10th flattener was now what I call the steroids. And the steroids are wireless, voice over IP, and file sharing. Napster, BitTorrent, things like that. And what these steroids are doing are turbocharging all six of these new forms of collaboration, so I can now do any one from anywhere with any device totally mobile.
By the way, were you the chief technical correspondent as well as the chief foreign correspondent?
No,
it's amazing what you turned out.
I just figured it all out after, you know, basically I was here.
But this book is probably the defining book in this age of how this platform is going to work. Because a lot of people are very worried about what your book says.
Yeah.
For example, it's been observed that we have inflationary spending in the United States, deficit spending, and so forth and so on, yet prices are not going up
right. Because
of the deflationary nature of China.
Yes.
A new force, something people haven't really thought through.
Right.
If we extend your ideas, that's going to be endemic, right? Because one of the things that happens now is it's a global market. Who are the people who are most negatively affected Google is an example of a company that's positively affected by these enormous things you've unearthed. Who are the people who are most threatened? How will they react? How does this play out? What's the map for the next 5 or 10 years?
Well, I think there's reason to worry, you know, and that's why the point I made, Eric and I both spoke this morning at the Thai Econ Conference, and one of the points I made to them and I made to the Business Roundtable this week is that I think business and businesses like Google are going to have to be more outspoken about defending both the challenges and the opportunities of this world. Because I think all the political incentives are going to be the other way. And I really smell that in Washington. Now, you know, what I tried to argue in thinking through your question, Eric, is that I have a chapter in the book called The Untouchables. And the argument is that when the world goes flat, the global caste system gets turned upside down. The highest castes become the untouchables. Untouchables are people whose jobs cannot be outsourced. Okay. Now, who would be an untouchable in this world? Well, I would argue there are going to be four categories. First are people who are really special. Michael Jordan, Barbara Streisand, they can't be outsourced. You know what I mean? These are people, Eric Schmidt, Sergey Brin, Larry Page, they can't be outsourced. Okay, you're right.
Not on that list.
Second are people who are really specialized. I'm sure 95% of the people in this room, people who are really have a specialized skill that is not fungible. And third are people who are really anchored. And that's going to apply to a lot of people. That's everything from your doctor to your nurse to your barber to the chef to all kinds of people whose jobs have to be done in a specific location, no matter how flat the world gets. But the fourth, and this really, I think, is what's going to apply to 90% of us, is going to be people who know how to learn how to learn. People who are really adaptable. Because it seems to me what's going to happen as the world goes flat, and as I watch Google, I think it's a perfect manifestation of this, we're connecting all the knowledge pools in the world together. That's what it really means. We're connecting the knowledge pools in India, the knowledge pools in China, the knowledge pools in Palo Alto more intimately than ever before. I think as a result, we're on the cusp of an era of innovation that's going to be remarkable. I interviewed somebody last week, and they told me Motorola is developing a cell phone that'll be sold for $12. And so all I could think of is when the $12 cell phone, the internet-enabled cell phone, meets Google, that means there's a lot of people in India and China are going to be walking around with all the world's knowledge in their pocket. And I believe that's going to lead to an explosion of innovation. The next great breakthrough in bioscience could come from a 15-year-old in Romania who downloads the human genome. You know, so the result of that is I think we're going to see creative destruction on steroids.
Well, in fact, in your column, you point out in the ACM programming contest,
that's right.
The winners, Shanghai, Beijing, all over the world.
We came in 17th. You know, so just to finish this point, Eric, is that I think that the really skill you need to be safe in this world is you got to be really adaptable. You got to be able to learn how to learn. Because, and I'm an example of this, I had to retool myself. I mean, I've just spent the last year completely re-engineering my skills. Because I went out in the world and I discovered, look, you can't write about the West Bank and Bosnia every week. You know, I mean, everyone else does, but I mean, I don't want to, you know. And so if you want to be relevant in explaining the world, I had to answer the questions that I couldn't answer. So I had to upgrade my skills. And I think we all, you know, are going to, that the future belongs to those who are really good at learning how to learn. And I think that's really the skill.
I want to ask one more question, and I'd like to encourage audience questions, which I think are always more interesting than my own.
Please.
In the last 15 years, you have really defined the analysis and coverage of the Middle East in many actions and made your mark there. You've now seen the world as this with a flat perspective, and I don't personally see the impact from this message on your former area of expertise, current expert area, and perhaps you'll go back to that. Mm-hmm. I don't see the changes happening yet in that part of the world from your thesis.
Right.
I 100% agree with your thesis. So what's wrong? Is it just time? Mm-hmm. Is it investment? I think it's all positive for the Middle East.
Right.
Everything you say should ultimately result in a more stable, better informed, better educated outcome.
Well, Well, that's a very good question, Eric. And I'd give you three ways, and they're not all positive, where the flat world is at work in that part of the world.
Does not work.
No, is at work. Oh, but they're not always positive. You know, one of the points I try to make in the book is that when the world goes, the flat world is a friend of Infosys and of Al-Qaeda. Mm. Okay, and to me, Al-Qaeda, and what I've done is basically take my analysis now, reapply it to the Middle East. And so when I do that, what I see when I look at Al-Qaeda, I see nothing more than an open source global supply chain. The person who understood supply chains better or as well as Sam Walton was Osama bin Laden. And Al-Qaeda today is nothing more than a global open source suicide supply chain. You deploy a suicide bomber in Tikrit, and another is immediately recruited and deployed down the supply chain from somewhere else in the Muslim world. So that's one way. In fact, one of the points that I've been arguing, and I haven't been able to develop this because I don't have enough raw material, is, see, I think we're up against something in Iraq that we just don't know how to deal with. That we're still thinking vertically, command and control, when our enemy is thinking connect and collaborate. Mm-hmm. We're approaching it vertically, what is basically a horizontal enemy. Mm-hmm. And I think we're dealing, as I say, with a kind of suicide supply chain, and we've never faced anything like this before. It's a very flat organization, and we don't quite know how to get our arms around it. So that's kind of one area where I'd say the flat world applies. Another area, and this is to the negative, is when the world goes...
The first one wasn't?
Yeah, the first one. This is also to the... This is even more to the negative. When the world goes flat, you get your humiliation fiber optically. Okay. You get your humiliation at 56K. And because you can see just where the caravan is and just how far behind you are. Okay. And if you believe, as I do, that what is really behind 9/11 is humiliation, a deep sense of a proud civilization having fallen behind, the flattening of the world intensifies that enormously. But in the upside, I don't think you have the Cedar Revolution in Lebanon without the flattening of the world. Lebanese were sitting there, they watched exactly what happened in Georgia, exactly what happened in Ukraine. They said, wait a minute, if these guys can do that, why can't we? And in talking to Lebanese friends, they made that very clear. They were watching all of this play out on satellite. Now, the accident, the tragic accident of Hariri being killed, the prime minister, which triggered all this, that obviously was necessary, but the flattening of the world was a sufficient thing to make it possible. That part of the world, what keeps it resistant, I would say, is that it's... is oil. It's the curse of oil. And so it allows you to build certain barriers for a time against these pressures of globalization. And right now, because of the windfall in oil, they've really, they've been able to, you know, keep the dam up, basically. But I think it's only a matter of time. The flattening is and will come there. The Berlin Wall is falling in the Arab Muslim world today. That's the good news. The uncertain news is that Vaclav Havel is not on the other side. Uh-huh. Okay. And neither is Lech Walesa, neither is the Solidarity Trade Movement. That's not a bad thing. I mean to that only to say that they have a very different attitude toward the West, a very different set of political actors, a much more complex society. It isn't a group of people just dying to jump into our arms as we had in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. And so when the flattening comes there and the wall comes down, it isn't so they can be pro-American or pro-Western. They're going to make their own way. They're going to shape their own thing. I'm still net positive about it. But it's going to be really, really complex. It's going to be one of the great dramas, I think, to watch on the world stage, how this plays out.
Let's get some questions from our audience. Who would like to begin?
You mentioned earlier that one of the major losers in this would be politicians, and that there would be resistance from that. Could you elaborate and possibly discuss what we, either individually or corporately, can do to ease their minds?
The question is really where are kind of politicians going to go with this, and what can any individual or company do to tilt it in the right direction. I don't say this to be cute. I say this to tell you something that I only realized when I got done with the book. I wrote a 488-page book about the next phase of globalization, and I didn't interview anyone in the US government. Hmm. And I live in Washington, D.C. I mean, I had a accidental conversation with Colin Powell that's in the book. I needed some reference, so I talked to a librarian at the National Science Foundation.
It doesn't count.
But I don't think either of those really count. And so I went for wisdom and insight, you know, somewhere else. I'm sure there are people in the government, you know, who could have helped. But this is just not really on the agenda, you know, of Washington, D.C. We've just, you know, the argument I'm making in the book is that we're going from vertical to horizontal, you know, in terms of how value will be created. My guess is, over time, this is going to be the mother of all inflection points. This is going to change everything. I think it's going to be, and Google's just part of this manifestation, it's this process, it's going to be bigger or as big as Gutenberg and the printing press when it's done. And just when we've reached this point, nobody's talking about it. You know, doing this book was a bit like being in a science fiction movie. And I go around and interview people, you know, like Eric or Sergey and Larry here, people at Microsoft, people at Intel, John Doerr and his friends. But talking to you all is like talking to pod people. You're like pod people in a science fiction movie. You all know the secret. And you're all doing it like crazy. Thank God. But nobody's told the kids. Nobody's told the kids. So we just had an election where Democrats were debating whether NAFTA was a good idea. And the Republicans put duct tape over the mouth of Chief White House economist Greg Mankiw when he said outsourcing made sense and stashed him in Dick Cheney's basement. Never to be heard from again. So right at the moment when we've reached, I think, a really important inflection point, no one's talking about it. And I think, so first of all, there's just a huge education responsibility and opportunity here. What world we're living in? What are the challenges and what are the opportunities? Now my guess is, you know, being on a book tour is a really interesting experience because you get to talk to a lot of normal people, basically, outside of Washington, D.C. And there, I would tell you, if you said, Tom, what did you learn on 6 weeks of book tour? I would tell you I learned there's a huge undertow of concern out there by parents about education. They sense something's going on out there, that their kids and that the political system is not discussing and preparing them for. They're really, I think, worried and confused about it. And no politician yet that I see, Democrat or Republican, has seized this and tried to define a political agenda about it. Nobody convened Congress at 12 midnight to discuss the fact that the National Science Foundation cut its budget by $100 million last year. And so your last point is the one I worry about. We're in a quiet crisis right now, I would argue. It's not going to change our standard of living overnight, tomorrow, the next day. But if we don't begin to adapt, I think it will. And as my friend Paul Romer says, you know, a crisis is a terrible thing to waste.
Go ahead.
Now, funny enough, the point I wanted to ask about has also to do with political backlash. It's not about a country you would expect intense austerity from, but the president of the major governing political party of Germany has come out and defined the international investing community as locusts, eating all they find in their wake. So reflecting on that, I don't really see a connection between the flattening that is terrifying German politicians and the kind of technological and social issues you mentioned, so much as to financial issues, the fact that capital is roaming the earth, whether for good or for ill. Do you have any reflections on that?
A good question. I would simply say two things. One is the last documentary we just did was about Europe and got a chance to look at that very at very close hand. I think Europe's in for just a tremendous tsunami, basically, from this flattening process. And compared to the social benefits they had and what they're likely to have to give up in order to realign themselves, you know, with this world, I think it's going to be politically enormously destabilizing. The you said something, I'm just sorry blanking out for a second on what the other point I wanted to make. I'll think of it in a second, I'm sorry, but that's sort of my broad reaction is that they're basically not having this discussion at all over there. I can see it in the contrast between the reviews of the book here and the reviews of the book there, you know. And I've still, my record on writing books on globalization is intact. Lexus and the Olive Tree was translated into 29 languages, all except one, French. Okay, and so my record is intact, and so far we don't, and I offered to give it away for a dollar, okay, to any French publisher who wanted it. So so I think that they still really have not gotten their mind around this story yet, and I think it's going to be politically very, very destabilizing.
They had that problem with Christopher Columbus.
They had that problem with Columbus too, exactly, same that's problem. Right.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
I like what you said about there being only a small group of people that whose jobs can't be outsourced, and I tended to agree with that. I was wondering if you'd thought further about what's the distribution going to be like of people who are in these different groups, meaning where's the middle class going to go? Are we just going to have divide up into people who are in this top class cast and everyone else, and there's going to be a big gap in the middle?
Yeah, let me. That's an important question too, and let me just say I don't know. You know. I really tried not to write a book of futurology, you know, and because there's a lot of those books out there, you know, in 5 years you'll be able to talk to your shoe and it'll turn your oven on at home and, you know, there'll be no middle class. And I really tried to write a book by saying, you know, here's the world as I see it. Here's how I'm trying to explain it. So part of my answer to you is I don't know. I spend so much time just trying to figure it out. But what I would say, what my gut tells me is that people are missing on the upside, is that two things happen when the world goes flat. One is the global economy gets bigger. Well, that's great if you're in the ideas business, you're in the knowledge business. Whether you're in the Google business or the Microsoft business or the New York Times business, the market is going to grow much bigger, okay? And it's also, I think what people miss, going to grow more complex. And I would take an example I've often used, John taught me this, from your own industry. I mean, 10 years ago, there was no Google, all right? And suddenly now, you know, this is considered, you know, one of the hottest, most dynamic companies in the country. Then someone comes along and realizes that, geez, if Tom Friedman's suitcase company comes up on Google ahead of Samsonite, there's like real dollars in that. So suddenly, you get an industry of search engine optimizers cropping up, you know, all around you. And it seems to me that basically, if you have knowledge skills, if you are what I would call a knowledge person, the worst that'll happen to you in a flat world is you will have to move horizontally, okay? That is, maybe China will, in 10 years, specialize in things that Google does today, or that are commodities. And people here will move horizontally into something else. I am convinced if you have the knowledge skills, there's gonna be a place for you. If you don't have the knowledge skills, you're gonna have to move vertically. You're gonna have to move from, you know, the non-knowledge world into the knowledge world. Now, when that happens, two good things happen. One, you get more people able to access these kind of jobs. And secondly, you shrink the pool of non-knowledge workers. And when you do that, the price of plumbers can charge goes from $75 to $100 an hour. So you actually benefit, as we all know, who've looked for, you know, either childcare or, you know, or a plumber or a carpenter. You want to shrink, you know, those jobs as well, the number, so their wages come up at the same time. So I don't, you know, the thing I always tell myself is that, look, after World War II, we stood astride the world, totally dominant. We had the only industrial economy standing. Japan was decimated and Europe was decimated. What do? We did the Marshall Plan. We built both of these countries up into huge competitors. And what happened? Our standard of living grew for 6 straight decades. It's because the global economy grows and it gets more complex, but it's very hard to see. And therefore, as it gets more complex, new industries, new jobs get spun off. As long as you have knowledge skills, you'll get one of them. And that's why I think the biggest challenge for us is, look, 100 years ago, 90% of Americans worked in agriculture. Today, 2% do. Well, had we all been watching Lou Dobbs back then, imagine what Lou Dobbs' show would have sounded like in about 1850, you know. You mean you're introducing a thrasher? What do you mean? Benedict Arnold, you know, you're introducing a combine? Do you know what this is going to do to people on the farm? Do you know how many jobs you're going to lose on the farm? Well, fortunately, Lou Dobbs wasn't around in 1850, but some other people were who started the high school movement and the land-grant universities. Yeah. You know, I was looking this up the other day. You know when we started our land-grant universities? 1862. Do you remember what was also happening in 1862? There was a little bit of a war going on here, okay, in our own country. It meant in the middle of the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln had the wisdom to start the land-grant universities. And it was thanks to the high school movement and the land-grant universities, we took all those people from the farm into the industrial age. Now we're going to have to take people in the industrial age into the post-industrial age, and you do that not with secondary education, but with post-secondary education. Community college, technical school, university. And I think the thing we should be talking about today is not taking apart the New Deal by privatizing Social Security. We need a new New Deal around tertiary education. That's the biggest thing. Let's not worry about the safety net, or let's get that right, but let's focus on the income opportunity, you know, not this side of it.
Hi. Speaking of supply chain companies like Walmart, do you think their labor and externalization of cost policies are intrinsic to being a supply chain company, or just part of their corporate culture?
Interesting question. You know, I spent a lot of time with Walmart on doing this book, and that was an interesting experience. And you really do have to go to Bentonville, Arkansas to understand Walmart. What I learned, you know, when I went to Bentonville, it all became clear to me, on the upside and the downside. First thing that strikes you about Bentonville is it really is in the middle of nowhere. I mean, this is Little Abner country. These are the Beverly Hillbillies, okay? So that's the first point that strikes you.
Running and the largest company in the world.
So then you have to question, how did Little Abner become the largest company in the world? And it's very interesting because they out-innovated all their, they're mean, they're nasty, they're tough, and they were the earliest adopters of every new technology, from computers to wireless to RFID. And so why were they? Well, it was, you know, that there's no mother like necessity, okay? That because they were out there in the middle of nowhere and had to get a global supply chain that could connect Bentonville, Arkansas with all of these places, they were early adopters. And that seems to me to be what Walmart doesn't get credit for, you know, I mean, that they out-innovated their competitors. That's what allowed them to be mean, nasty, and tough, you know. At the same time, it was precisely because they were in the middle of nowhere, not in the middle of Manhattan. They were just so focused on that, they lost sight of everything else. And they, like Baby Huey, just grew up to be the biggest company in America without developing any of the other habits, culture that you really need to go with that. Now, on the labor side, you know, I'm not so sure that it's I know what you're asking. I don't address it in the book, so I'm thinking on my feet, because people often ask me what comes after this, you know, and it does seem to me more machines talking to machines is really what comes after this. And I've got to believe that's going to be a big part of supply chain. And therefore, what that's going to mean for labor at the supply chain end, as opposed to the retail front, is probably, you know, not good in that sense for unskilled labor, would be my guess.
Yeah, let's go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Friedman. Since it's a technology company here, I thought I'd like to ask you a question about that. I noticed that many of the 10 triggers you mentioned were technologically oriented. I'm wondering, do you see any kinds of technological advancement over the next couple of years that you think are going to have a particularly strong influence, either for good or for bad, on this flattening process? Or maybe phrased another way, if, like, say you were working here, what would be the sorts of projects that you would be the most excited about right now?
And by the way, I think your offer is in the,
in the mail.
It's in your email.
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, worries me and what excites me. I kind of alluded to it. You know, what worries me is that the flat world really is a friend of Infosys and Al-Qaeda. And I see this more and more. Think about what terrorism used to be and what it is today. The old model of terrorism was we go out, we do an outrageous act, we get the New York Times and CBS to come and cover it, and we rattle everyone in the world. Not anymore. Now, I go to bed, I fire up AOL in the morning, and there's a message from Zarqawi, almost an email right to me on my, you know, right there on my screen. And so I'm worried about that. You know, one thing I've learned in doing all of this, terrorists are always early adopters. Terrorists are always early adopters. And I'm afraid if we're not as equally early adopters of the latest technology, that you know, that will be a real problem. So that's kind of on the downside, you know. On the upside, it just seems to me that really what I alluded to earlier, that that 15-year-old with a $12 phone and an internet connection that gets them onto Google in their own language, what the implications of that are going to be on the world, that's really, really going to be enormous. What worries me about it, though, a little as a quasi-public figure, is that we've moved into an age where the accusation is the punishment. You know, that you're, you know, my daughter goes off to college, and before she goes, and I'm sure you've all heard this story from your own experiences, and she starts telling me about her roommates, and I say, well, what, how do you know this? And she said, I Googled them. I said, well, you mean your roommates have a Google profile? I mean, these are high school kids, you know what I mean? And so in this flat world, the accusation is the punishment. And your Google reputation now will just stick with you. Mark Twain said, you know, always tell the truth and you never have to remember what you said. And and it's like doubly true now in a world of Google. You know, I mean, you better behave well because your Google reputation, you know, is going to stick with you. And so those are just some of the things randomly that I'm thinking about. But I can just tell you, as I said earlier, I just wrote a whole book, and my research assistant was Google. I wrote this book in 9 months from a standing start. I never could have done it without search at the level of today. There's no question about it. And so for someone who's like really smart and a scientist, that's got to be really, really exciting.
Yeah, well, thank you. Let's hope. Go ahead.
You can look at the history of the corporation as kind of to see lessons learned and best practices about people learning how to collaborate and becoming more productive. And along with that history, you see a trade-off with like the free market versus government intervention to like also protect as well as to encourage innovation. So now with the flat world that crosses political boundaries, what do you see as the proper role for our government or other governments to get involved in regulating this process?
It's an important question. I kind of lay out my own philosophy in the book, which I call compassionate flatism. I believe, since we never really did compassionate conservatism, we might as well get compassionate flatism. Because my argument is that basically this flattening process, this is going to be as big as a challenge as communism. And if we don't have as comprehensive a response to flatism as we did to communism, it's going to be enormously destabilizing. So let me go through quickly the points that I, you know, believe are important. First of all, it requires a different kind of political leadership. It requires political leaders who won't make us stupid, who will actually explain to us the world we're living in, both the challenges and the opportunities, and to get excited about the opportunity. There's something incredibly exciting about it. I can feel it every time I come to Google. But when was the last time you heard a politician really get excited about this world? So that's number one. And as an analog to that, I happen to believe that you know, there is such an obvious opportunity for President Bush to inspire the same kind of excitement about science and engineering that President Kennedy did with the moonshot, to get young men and women to go into science and engineering in the numbers that did in the Kennedy day. And that, to me, is energy independence. To make energy independence the moonshot of our generation, to get every young person excited about going into science or engineering, to make their contribution to the environment, to geopolitics, to the deficit, by making America energy independent, it's so out there, it's so obvious, and it would be so compelling. So first level, different kind of political leadership. Secondly, I believe we need national health care, some version of national health care. I can't tell you how many CEOs I interviewed who said, we're moving jobs abroad because I don't want the unfunded liability of the health care. You know? Short of that, we definitely need totally portable pensions and totally portable health care so people can take their pensions and health care as they move from job to job and be as flexible as this world demands. Third, I think we need wage insurance. And this is an idea I lay out in the book. It's not my idea. Lori Kletzer and Bob Lighton lay this out as a way of easing people who get caught in this into new jobs quickly. Fourthly, I believe that we need to make tertiary education, post-secondary education, available to every American who wants it. I think it's just, you know, it's the only solution, you know. Lastly, we need a different form of parenting. We're now blending with two cultures, India and China, that have a very high ethic of education. And that's why my advice is, you know, I mean, to myself as a parent, is, you know, throw away the Game Boy, shut off the stupid television, and get Johnny and Susie down to work. Because I probably said this last time, but, you know, when I was growing up, my parents used to say to me, Tom, finish your dinner. People in China and India are starving. And I tell my girls, finish your homework, because people in China and India are starving for your job. And in a flat world, they can have it. You know, Bill Gates pointed out something to me in the book that, and I think it's very important to keep in mind, when 30 years ago, if you had a choice of being born a B student in Palo Alto, or a genius in Bangalore or Beijing, there was no question you wanted to be a B student in Palo Alto, because your life choices and opportunities would be so much greater as a B student in Palo Alto than a genius in Bangalore and Beijing. When the world is flat, you do not want to be a B student in Palo Alto, because every genius in Bangalore and Beijing can now plug and play, compete, connect, and collaborate in ways they never could have before. And so I think it takes a different approach to parenting. As I said in my column this morning that Eric alluded to, I've had this feeling for a while that we are our Olympic basketball team. You know, the sort of lackadaisical team that just sort of thought they could show up, and they came home with the bronze medal. And the way in which our Olympic basketball team has kind of mirrored the national mood, I think, is something to keep in mind.
Go ahead.
Thank you again for coming. I imagine that the flattening of the world would impact most places that are otherwise have been isolated and are perhaps not.
Can you speak a little closer to the mic?
Oh, sure. I would imagine that the flattening of the world would impact most the places that have been isolated up until now. And the U.S., in my mind, is not the most closed community. For instance, it has been importing skilled and educated people for a long time. A lot of the same people who had to be able to learn and to adapt, a lot of them are in this room. It has had a pretty free press, and the capital markets are pretty well functioning. So when you say that the U.S. is woefully unprepared, I'm curious, do you mean, is it compared to the optimum or compared to other countries? And what should we do to be prepared? And also, what do you teach your kids? How do you prepare for what's coming?
Good. It's a good question. I think it's compared to the optimum. I think it's compared to what we could be given the natural resources that we have as a country. And I mean not just material ones, but institutional ones, just what you referred to. The best research universities in the world, the best rule of law, the best intellectual property protection. I think we got all the secrets of the sauce to succeed in this world. The question is, are we enriching them? Are we investing in them? What are we doing cutting the National Science Foundation budget by $100 million, you know, last year at this moment in time? So it's really that. It's really trying to attention people to that issue, to those choices that I'm really trying to focus on. I don't think we're in a crisis today, but in 15 years, I think we could be in a crisis, you know, that one that really would affect our standard of living. Look, our relative lead over the world is going to shrink. That's inevitable. The question is whether our absolute lead does. And I think that depends on what we do.
So we're pretty much running out of time. We've got four Googlers who have important questions. In the spirit of moving forward, Larry, can you ask your question? Will, and we'll have Kim and Peter and so forth. And then maybe you could give a combined answer as
great.
A...
Oh.
As a This is a test. But you're going to do well. Larry, go ahead.
Oh, actually, I wanted to answer one of your questions first.
That's not what right. I asked.
Now I know I'm at Google.
Well, no, you asked when was the last time you heard a politician who was generally interested in technology. Both Colin Powell and Al Gore visited recently, and to my viewpoint at least, they both genuinely were. So they do exist. I didn't actually have a question as much sort of a request for comments.
Please.
About two ideas. One of them is competition, and the other one is what I like to call the militant moderates. So basically on the competition side, the basic question there is, has in history or in present or going future, there been a country, society, or company that's ever been able to thrive and survive in the absence of any threat or any competition? And then the question on the moderate side is I'd sort of take the fundamental viewpoint that the average or the majority is in fact moderate, and I was just sort of wondering when these various things are happening, when there's the various turmoil, at what point does that majority actually regain the power mm-hmm. from the extremes?
So Kim,
good point.
Go ahead.
Very quickly. So to what extent are you concerned that we're creating a new underclass of people who, no matter how educated they are, simply don't have the intellectual capability to keep up in this new world, and what do we do about that? So it's no longer access to capital. It's
again. Go ahead, Peter.
So first of all, thanks for doing your research on Google. And I recognize that now the responsibility for eliminating errors in the New York Times
is partially
shifted from you to my team.
I believe you are the director of quality, right? So the responsibility is directly on you.
So we'll try not to let the Times down. But I wanted to say on the the U.S. finishing 17th in the ACM contest, I think that's a little bit alarmist to worry about that. The way I interpret it is if you're a hot team of programmers in India or Latvia, the best thing you can do is go make your name on that contest. Whereas if you're in the U.S., you go out and start a company.
Interesting.
And it seems
that's
like it's still easier to do that here.
It's a good point. That's interesting.
The answer to this question is going to be interesting enough, so I'm not going to ask mine. And yeah, I'll just see you afterwards.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. next question, yeah. And the question of are we creating an underclass, I mean, any more than the underclass we already have, again, I'm going to retreat into I just don't know. I think we're so new into this flattening process that it's very hard to predict how it will come out, and I think there's so many political choices yet to be made it's very hard to say anything categoric about that. Charlie Rose asked me, who would you like to read this book? And I said, without question, I'd like President Bush to read the book. And I wasn't being cute at all, for a very simple reason. listen to it on tape or whatever works for him. right. They're so bad up here, okay? That's right. This front row is terrible, okay? But I really meant that because in the sense that we don't have 3.5 years to waste. We don't have 3.5 years, and this really gets back to Larry's question of to sit around and wait and hope that someone 3.5 years from now gets it better. I really don't want to waste 3.5 years. I think that we're in a quiet crisis. As Shirley Ann Jackson, the head of Rensselaer Polytechnic, describes it. And she, is one of the people, Shirley Ann Jackson's the first African-American woman to win a PhD in physics from MIT. And she was part of that generation of scientists and engineers who were inspired by the moonshot, to go into science and engineering. So, to repeat what Paul Romer said, we are in a crisis, and a crisis is a terrible thing to waste. I would hate to waste this crisis.
Every time I talk to you, I feel like I need to talk to you for another 10 hours to understand at this level. It is an extraordinary vision that you have laid out. I'm sure you're right. And I'm glad.
I hope so, because I quoted Google awful lot.
And I'm really, really glad that you were willing, and you know, you're busy. Absolutely. You were willing to come back here and talk to us. Now, we wanted to present you with the Google Web Accelerator Boomerang. Oh,
wow.
And the reason is, first, we're very proud of this product, which makes your internet much faster, which is very important in flattening. But also, it's because boomerangs always come back.
Now, oh, terrific. Yeah.
I actually wanted to do something unusual. I wanted to ask one person in the audience to make some comments or wrap up or generally say whatever he would like to do. And so I prepared the microphone, and I'm going to present him with the boomerang as well.
Terrific.
And terrific. Perhaps, perhaps, perhaps I can give you a, I'm feeling lucky. And
thank you. Thank you. I have a very large hard drive right now. Thank you. On behalf of the new German Pope. Stand up on the stage.
Yeah, why don't you come on stage?
Thank you. First of all, it's a flat world. This is a Rubik's Cube. I was just wandering around your building and going, Jesus, you have no furniture. So that will be the future. In a flat world, you won't sit, and you'll have food every 100 feet. Hey, what a wonderful thing. This is basically an Aboriginal word processor. In the old days, there were people. That was the first Aboriginal modem. That was Marion Makeba's answering machine. The folks up there have been looking down on you for the entire the whole day, going, "We're so much better than you." And this is actually the intestine for the building. This is, you don't know it, but this is taking everything that you take from the every 100 feet, runs it through there, and vents it out to you over a period of time. For me, I've been just watching and enjoying. Like he said, he was hoping that Bush reads the book or gets it on tape or at least sees some pictures. He's a simple man, and as he himself said, is our children learning? Which, you know, gets a lot of kids excited about, is they learning? If you look up Google, look up Bush and Google, it's really pretty open-ended. And it's not a porn site, even though many of you are thinking that. Even though Dick Cheney sounds like, It's Revenge of the South, really. Yeah. Do what I say now, George, you will be my friend. He's a good man. I'm hoping that somehow that he has an AI working with him. He has a GPS actually on his desk that tells him where certain parts of the world are and how to get there. When machines start talking to machines, that will be a scary thing. I have I had a Mercedes-Benz that had a phone that could dial. You could, you know, you speak out the number, I would go one, it would go two. It was German, it was always wanting more. And it gave me directions one day. I wanted to get to Marin County. It directed me to basically the middle of the bay. And if I could get there, probably the car would be going, this is obviously great. It's a company as bright as you are, need to have your name that big. You're up there going, this is where we work. We're special. We have skills. We have a search engine. I love seeing that globe out there. It basically has all of those, you know, now many of you look behind you like, where? Sergey, put it there. Big gift for you all. Big gift for Sergey to Google. Sergey came here with dream for search engine. In Russia, search engine was, where are pants? Jeans, over there. But it's great. You can see people actually, all the places all over the world that have electricity. Not a lot of hits in Africa, right? Okay. It's nice to have the tech people in the front going,
when will you talk about hardware? Talk about mainframes and accessing mainframes.
It is a good day to wonder why. I actually called Stephen Hawking's house. Hello, this is Stephen Hawking. Yeah, I'd like to leave a message. No, this is Stephen.
People get very offended by that. I don't know why I'm doing following you.
That's good. Are you kidding? Makes my day.
For those, this is a Freudian moment right here. You have a ball. I don't know what this is. Even Magritte is going, I would not paint it. Read the book. It's an exciting book. For those of you, obviously, you're at the tip of the culture. The rest of us are going, what do we do? I hope I have a skill. I hope that there's not somebody in Bombay right now doing this. I could do your act word for word. Well, I could also dance in your videos. Change the light bulb, change the light bulb. You could be in Crouching Tiger, you would not knowing why. Watch now, you will learn. I will dub you better than you. Your culture is falling apart. And even the English are going, get ready. Look at us. We have, well, look at the royal family. It's basically Deliverance staged by Fortnum and Mason. We have to look at them and realize there's a culture, a very well-educated culture, the royal family. All of that money and no dental plan. That's some pretty ugly people for being the head of a nation going, hello, I'm getting married. Sorry. The New York Times, though, it's a good paper. Yeah, we've got new fact checkers now. Is this real? I don't know. There is a new Israeli web server called Netanyahu. Or you've got Moyle. It's a word. Yeah, Goigle. Gentile web server, Goigle. Well, thank you for letting me riff up here in front of people with college degrees. This is cool. A lot of the engineers will go up in the flowchart going, two Jews could walk into a bar. Or two Irishmen. No, they never walk out. It's like the two Irish guys in the boat going, oh, tired, Bob, I got to piss, I got to take a piss. He said, I want to make a wish first. He said, all right, make a wish. I wish the ocean was Guinness. Was great. And the ocean is Guinness. And then the other one said, you damn idiot, what have you done that for? I said, oh, why? What are you pissed off for? I said, now where am I going to piss? Shut up, you Bob. I wish us all good luck. The German Pope, I just speak briefly about this. I was hoping, I mean, obviously it is an unusual thing that his nickname was the Panzer Pope. Obviously, the Swiss Guard is very happy because finally they get artillery. I was hoping for maybe a Brazilian Pope. I mean, Pope Raul would be lovely. That and the nuns going baningua bebening. Beba la guan bebin da se mo wan bayenga bayo. The African Pope, Pope Akali Marmigek. Or you can have an African American Pope, or we call him Pope Diddy. I got the bling right here. I got my ring and thing. All my biatches, I like to call my nun swatches. You know they're here right now. Look at my jewelry. Yo, check the ermine. I'm looking ha-ha. P. Diddy in the house riding in the Pope mobile. I guess I'm not going to heaven, but what the hell? You've got a helicopter waiting. I've got a hybrid. if those of you who have a hybrid, good luck. It's basically a golf cart on steroids. It makes a noise when it backs up, so even deaf people go. I imagine I'll go home tonight and go, what the fuck have I done? I've stood in front of people who have access to technology. Wait, hold on, let me take a picture of you. I actually saw a mobile phone that didn't have a camera. I went, oh, you sad bastard. It's so crazy. Now, everyone has these little headsets, and they're talking like, oh, God, ha, 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 ha. No, hold on. I actually saw a guy who was talking to himself and went, thank you. Thank you for still being out of your fucking mind. Thank you. How small will the technology get? Will it be like, okay, you eventually get it implanted going, yeah, hold on 1 second. Yep. Oh, yeah, hold on. Yeah, I'm getting a call. Hold on, I got a call waiting. Wait a minute. Yeah, I'm going to take a picture now. Yeah, I just took a picture. I'm downloading. Oh, wait, I'm getting your fax. Hold on. Thomas Friedman, ladies and gentlemen.
Robin Williams! Woo! Robin!
Oh, that was great. Thank you very much. That was great, thanks.
Yeah, Eric was complaining that my jokes TGIF were getting stale, so he brought a ringer. You don't have to get Robin Williams, though. Well, thank you very much, Tom, for coming. By the way, you know, I thought because of your book came out shortly after we launched the satellite view and maps, I thought, wow, that was fast. You know, right away, he saw that and he wrote the whole book, The World is Flat. But now, thanks to it, we can delay some of the work we're going to do on Keyhole, which is the 3D viewer, and I know that's not necessary anymore. But anyway, thank you very much for coming by.
Pleasure.
It's always a pleasure. And a round of applause for Tom Friedman.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That was great, Tom. Really great.
Could not have been better.
It's terrific. Really
great.
Makes my day. This was great. I used to have one request. You've got to get me a picture with him. Okay. Brin, I got to get a picture of Robert.